you have points of information, I'm going to try and move this and sit near the microphone so I can chat properly. At the back there, what's your name?
Michelle.
I do know that, sorry. And in front of you, somebody had their name, was it?
Yeah.
Did you have your hand up?
Yeah.
Okay, right, one second, I'm Michelle first. Okay, Michelle first, and then John.
There are a number of questions that I've got, and if you don't say straight away, then you could always come to me afterwards and let me know. With Somers Town, there's two parks. One's being sort of developed immediately around it. One is going to be covered, say, in half of it's going to be covered in housing. And currently, that is populated with 40-year-old trees that are, this is a really polluted area. It's basically just up the road to the station and on your left. But there is a problem. I have some questions, but I think there is clearly a major problem. And I have written to Georgia, but I've just compiled before coming today something really simple, which I did say I would do as well. Because I thought as time goes by, you know, we can simplify issues much better as time goes on. And so this is what I hope to do now, and it'll only be a few minutes. But what it is...
Michelle, we're doing
quite
some information questions to the panel right now. So
yeah, well, I do have some important questions, as I do. So you said they've broken their own rules. What I'm going to say is there's an EU law, and it's about pollution, and it's the reason is it's because of health. So nitrogen dioxide, 40 is the level, and the sort of health things we're talking about is when there's even tiny increases, research shows heart attacks, and there's more, but asthma in children, so that's pretty bad as well. So where the CIP is, and this was information given in the meeting where they decided, the pollution where the tower block is being built is 46, so hugely over the 40, or 60, those two numbers given. So perhaps, this is the question, there's an ethical issue of bringing people to live there. And at the very top, we've got the emissions from the creek, so that they're actually stopping the air from going into those upper one, so there is a limit somehow, that an arbitrary one, that they don't want people to suffer. But the main issue, can I just say though, this is the main issue, and Slade reminded me, when the council brought in these experts to say, do an environmental assessment, they have said the scope is only the new residents coming in, and the problem is we've got Cooper's Lane. They're in even more pollution than the new flats would be because they're right near the taxi rank. The people there are ill, and the pollution's going to increase for two reasons. So there is some questions here. One is because all the trees are being taken. No, but in a way, there's no question. But in the decision
meeting, you really need to ask a question though, because we are.
No, what
you want? I mean, genuinely.
No,
honestly, pollution could not be more higher on my list.
Okay, so the question is, they did say that the traffic from the tower block was only going to be like one car a day. The heat produced was only going to. Well, actually, I think it's not going to produce pollution because it's coming from combined heat and power in the next door Phoenix block or whatever. But what's blatant to me, but wasn't in the meeting, they said no. The expert said no, taking away all these trees, I can't remember, is it 20? It isn't going to increase the pollution, but actually, you know, there is research, there's a deaf scientist that says so, there's a mayor. And this is another question to you, Sean, isn't it? Apparently, it's the mayor's responsibility to reduce the pollution. So in this case, what I'm saying is, and especially for the Cooper's Lane residents, especially, it's increasing it, and it's just not right, and it's just not acceptable. And that's from taking away the trees, and also, and this is admitted, the actual building of the block, I believe, is just sort of without question, but it wasn't in the scope. They said, oh, it was in emails, they're sort of covering themselves.
Okay.
You know,
thank
it wasn't
you.
In their scope.
Thank you very much. I think we get your point now. Derek, what's your question?
Yeah, several questions. One, are all the proposed CIP development schemes, including the ones also being worked on now, debt free? Because I'll give you an example, one, a CIP scheme that's about to happen soon, which is the Highgate Community Centre. When I was Chair of Leisure Services, I was responsible for buying that site from the Territorial Army. I can't remember how long we agreed to pay for that particular piece of land. Are we still paying for that site? And if we are, why are we selling it debt laden? Another question is, you mentioned Chester Banmore. The officers know the people who have bought on that site are renting. They're not doing anything about it. I don't know why the TA out there, given that the council officers, the names of the people who bought and are renting, their names show up on the electoral register as being tenants and not the owners. So, and the council still doesn't do anything. In Kentish Town DMC, we've got Maiden Lane coming on stream in September, and that's 2 years overrun. And the same thing has happened there. I've asked.
Can I clarify when you're talking about subletting of tenants or leaseholders
Leaseholders are subletting their flats in defiance of the agreement they've got with Camden.
And they've agreed not to do that.
Yeah. And I've asked the same about the Maiden Lane estate. I've asked, are the people who are buying flats on Maiden Lane, and you've quoted £625,000, that's for a one-bedroom flat which faces the railway, so you're not going to get much sleep because the freight line is going for all night. And the other thing is, you mentioned use of pension funds. I asked Pat Callaghan why Camden Council would not use its own pension fund as a way of funding the SIP schemes, and I was told it wasn't financially viable. They didn't think it would be a safe investment.
that's a pretty big vote of confidence there, isn't it?
Property is not a safe investment.
We've heard that we've heard that infill projects are an exception, and all over the country, councils are being criticised for exaggerating the costs of infill, and that it's exaggerating the bad state of the buildings that would undergo the infill, in order to justify the much more expensive. Lengthy demolition and rebuild. So I wonder whether there are grounds for similar suspicions in the case of Camden.
Slade, you were saying something about
Michelle, you're right. Camden said that they.
We can't hear you.
Technology. Yeah, Michelle, you're right. Camden said that the air pollution across most of the central Somerset site was 39.5 tons of nitrogen dioxide, which is just under the EU 40 limit, and they did a study to prove that. In fact, HS2 at the same time have been running a year-long study with fusion tubes, and they've got a baseline of 44 across the same area. So I do think that that Somers Town is in an area of illegal air quality, and that they shouldn't be building anything there at all. But also, they sold it to the community as being air quality neutral, and as if that was not going to have any impact. Air quality neutral is just a standard for building across London, but it's not actually. The buildings themselves, as you point out, aren't going to be as good for our environment as the trees and grass are there at the moment. I mean, they are building on the green side, and that's unheard of in London, I think.
If I could say something about the debt question, I will look into that for Highgate New Town. They're not selling it off, though. They are. this is the thing about the SIP as opposed to the other options that they're looking at. I have a question for myself at the moment about selling off. But basically, with that site, they're developing it themselves. I didn't spot any future commitments to still carry on paying off the TA, the Territorial Army Liability Assessment, but I have another look at that because I think that's very interesting. Leaseholders renting out. So this is one of the things about the private homes that they're selling. They're putting conditions into the leases that they put out to people, that they give to people when they sell those flats for like £600,000, that say you're not allowed to be doing it as a buy-to-let investment. With nominally, the council's against that. But they do seem to turn a blind eye to that. I think they are being marketed by Savills. If you look at the Savills website, which is called Camden Collection, you can see they're not being marketed as investments. The wording is not there, but the imagery, the implication is that you should be being they should be attractive to buy to let landlords. And I think if they are turning a blind eye to people who are long term renting them out as opposed to just temporarily doing it when they're away for a year or something.
Can I ask a supplementary question?
I want to know is,
I asked Camden Council as well, because Savills are a multinational company with offices in Singapore and Hong Kong, and I asked them, are they marketed them via Hong Kong and Singapore, or do they know if they're being marketed by through Hong Kong and Singapore, and they said they didn't know.
And they didn't care. So, yes, I understand it. There are commitments to only looking to market it locally, which is why you see adverts for XY apartments in the CIA, I think. That's it. Hello there. I think that's correct. So, XY apartments is the Maiden Lane flats. You do see adverts locally for those. Camden Town Pension Fund, I mean, that's a really good point. Other councils have put together investment funds. I think possibly it is Islington, I was just trying to look it up. But I think at least other councils have put their own investment funds, you know, put their money where their mouth is and put their own pension funds into their own projects. And that is something Camden can think about. When it comes to attracting investment funds, so the way that Camley Street have got a pension fund interested in investing in their project, Camden has limits on borrowing. But there are ways of working with other councils to put together, a long-term investment fund that then invests in council homes. It's not beyond them if they're committed to it. Les asked about infill and whether or not the council's underplay, whether those are options. I mean, infill when it comes to like doing a garage site or something like that, I think not, because they're doing some of those and they like those. If it's infill versus demolition, councils, and I think Camden are guilty of this completely, will make exaggerated claims about the state of the buildings. They'll make exaggerated claims about how much it costs to refurbish, and they've definitely done that with the Highgate New Town Community Centre, where they're demolishing that and rebuilding and putting in lots of homes and no affordable housing whatsoever. The cost of refurbishing it, they definitely overestimated that. So I think that is, once they set themselves on a course, once they want to do a particular project, because of the lack of transparency, because you can't see the actual numbers, because the viability assessment comes back redacted, it is impossible to properly interrogate whether their numbers are right. And I think that is a genuine problem Camden suffers from, just the way that Lambeth are suffering from that over central real estate. Question here, and then...
My name is Michael. There are many, many better ways to do this. I was the pro bono town planner for 6 years with Somerset. Firstly, an open book policy is essential.
Absolutely.
It means instead of redacting the costs and the returns, and you actually can see the costs and returns. Always the costs are up and the returns down, and accompanying an open book policy, you need access to independent commercial valuation advice.
When you say you mean the residents?
Yes, or not necessarily residents. Well, where yes, but preferably a neighbourhood forum, a legitimate and authorised by Camden Council umbrella structure, logically representative of the neighbourhood, or that kind of arrangement. Secondly, through my experience with Somerstown, there were many, many opportunities for partnership working between the neighbourhood forum and the relevant planners, the regeneration, housing, and other school interests in that area. As one example, the school positively refused point blank to explain to us sensibly why. Stanley showed one earlier option for the CIP, which did, from Camden, have housing extension in Charrington Street further on down on this school site. King's Cross Academy's got 262 units above it. St Mary's St Pancras has got 150 student units above it, Netley School and so on. So an open book policy, partnership working. I mean, we were not anti-development, far from it. No, genuinely, we weren't, and I hope so, I'm sure so, you will confirm that. But, and I suspect she meant do minimum rather than do nothing on your slide. But there is a case for just doing the minimum to realise the value, to rebuild the school, for example, rather than piling up the profits and who knows where they're all going to. But not to Somerstown, let's put it like that. Now, the third thing is rather more controversial. Maybe that is controversial, but the third thing is controversial. The idea that developers want to provide affordable housing. there must be abundant evidence in decades now that this is kind of cuckoo land, really. You didn't mention in your research examples where developers are, as at King's Cross, saying, coming back to the local planning authority and saying, oh, sorry, I find this is not viable, I'm going to give you cash in lieu. Maybe it would have been a useful part of your research
decade of my life working on King's Cross.
Right.
By the way, I
spent 12 years of my life working at King's Cross for the Romance Group. But cash in lieu is a prime example of developers just deciding, no, we can't possibly do this, it's not going to be viable. There's got to be a better way of providing genuinely affordable housing. Now, a community land trust may be one way, but personally, I actually can't see why the cap on council borrowing can't be removed and all sorts of constraints like that. There's a whole range of ways in which, councils used to build hundreds of thousands of genuinely affordable housing when I was a younger man. There are a whole range of ideas in the community developed. Look, Coyne Street, for example, you've got four ethnic minority co-ops on riverside land opposite the Houses of Parliament. Are you with me? Yes, but you see the point I'm making, that there is another way. I'd better stop.
Yeah. We appear to have entered the general discussion phase right on time, so that's good. I won't answer any of those. I don't think we need to answer any of those, boys. Next up.
Great, thank you, my Dee. Quick point of information and a question. Between mid-February and mid-June this year, an organisation called Camden Air Action which is formed of local community groups, transitions and others, and also working with parents and teachers, monitor the air pollution outside every school in Camden. That's 100 schools. And we found that at all of them, the air pollution, the nitrogen dioxide levels were actually very close to or above illegal limits. And that's throughout Camden. And actually, there's not a lot of difference between whether you're in a highly urban area or a leafy area. So actually, any council thinking of any developments should not do anything that is likely to make air pollution worse and should be actively trying to reduce it. Because even the legal limit of 40 micrograms per cubic meter is unhealthy. The World Health Organization recommends 20. And then we have to be very careful, because if you do a redevelopment in one area, you can throw pollution into an area that's otherwise okay. So therefore, we have to be very, very careful, and Camden should be absolutely cognizant of that, what it's doing to the health of our children. But my question is about the numbers of new council housing, because I wonder if there is any data on the actual size of the dwellings that are being made available. Because it might be that it's a two-bedroom for a two-bedroom, but we know that some of the ones that are being developed were, some people may say that they're generous sizes, they were built to Park and Morris standards. Some of us might just say that they're actually livable homes and not rabbit hutches. And I just wondered, as people looked at what people are getting in terms of these new council homes, in terms of space and outside space.
Thank you for that question. What Tom mentioned in his presentation was he said Matthew Crampton's spreadsheet. And what Matthew Crampton's spreadsheet does is something that we haven't done in our project, actually, because it was looking at, for the Gospel Oak schemes, specifically the amount of floor area that was being provided of affordable homes and council homes compared with the total. And that's a different way of looking at it. We're doing it in terms of number of dwellings. That's one of the planning criteria, but actually the planning criteria are also quite clear about floor area. And it's even worse when you do the floor area comparison than when you do the number of dwellings comparison. And they are, in some cases they're making homes bigger. The Holly Lodge scheme in Camden, in Highgate, they're converting a lot of bedsits, which are very small, into a smaller number of bigger homes. So doing the calculations for this scheme was interesting to do, we had to do an estimate because arguably the bed sits did need to go, and we did need more larger homes there. But in other schemes, like in Gospel Oak, I think they are demolishing the Bacton homes, and the ones that are re-providing are not as big. People also, when they're moved out, you might have a three-bedroom flat. When you're moved back, you're entitled to what you need, according to the council, which might be a two-bedroom flat. So you won't necessarily get like-for-like moving back. The other thing I didn't mention, actually, if you remind me now, in my presentation, is we looked at the number of people who are actually using their right to return. And only a few schemes have been completed, and one of them they wouldn't give us the information. But of the two they did give us the information on, only 20% of the residents who moved out moved back. So Chester Valmore, 20 residents moved out, 5 came back to live there. So even though you've got a net gain in council homes within Highgate, we've pretty much broken up the little community that lives in that area. They didn't all come back, they maybe didn't, it was their choice, they maybe didn't want to, they'd been moved out for 3 years, they didn't want to move again. But even so, the effects, the social effect is like another thing, it's not secondary. Okay. Now I've got three people on this side of the room, so I'll go to you first. Give us your name when you speak. And then you behind, which you can't see, and then this chap.
I'm Luke from Wendy. Couple of questions. First of all, are there any Labour councillors in the room? So that's a facetious question. Second one is around all this transparency and openness of information. Some of you may know that when they were going through the early stages of countless consultations of people who've lived on the estate long before even I was born have been used to this. This is how do we get this information? We've asked for these liability assessments, and we've been asking simple questions that they can't provide answers. They keep changing the teams that work on the consultation from their side in terms of officers and the information. If I drew a graph of what we've had and what we now get, it goes like this. It just, information disappears. So it's how have we, not only Wendy, but everyone else who's involved, addressed the issue that you've raised? And the final point is, I think alluding to Les's point earlier about making refurbishment worse than demolition. And again, this is something we're seeing on our estate on a daily basis. Again, isn't this a failure of Camden as the landlord to tenants and as a freeholder to leaseholders of their basic obligations? That why should the community have to pay through financial or social breakup and people losing jobs in the case of industrial and retail areas for their misguidance? And I don't like to bring this up, but obviously with everything that's happening in the light of Grenfell and the scrutiny on basic obligations of the local authority, isn't this just another failing that is going to come out and goes back to the transparency that eventually people are going to put up formal legal objections through information and coming together? It's just going to make your 2-year average delay increase further out, and no one's going to end up with additional housing that actually everyone wants, whether you're a leasehold or tenant. We do want more council housing. So just, that's my point.
Thank you.
Thank you. Your 800 lost housing years figure was an interesting one. And sorry, Rowan.
Rowan, thank you.
I was wondering if you had any information on the where households were relocated in the interim period as new housing was being developed. And you actually then answered my second question, which was information on how many had taken up their right to return. But I'm kind of interested to know if that does that right to return still involve rent increases on the council houses. So do you have any inkling on as to why people the take up of rights to return was so low?
Good question. I'll go to you.
Yeah.
Sorry,
well,
just three questions. Capital loans to council plan is up to £525.5 million. Now going to borrow, because we had a CHRA meeting at Fran's DMC a couple of weeks ago, and they plan to borrow another £40 million to finance the CIPs for the next few years, was it? 5 years, was it, Fran?
I'll have to check that. They definitely were going to borrow another
ball 40.
On the headroom.
Can you expand those acronyms? Because not everybody has come in with HIA, ANC.
Yeah, sorry, yeah.
Thank you.
Sorry about
that. Sorry. It's the District Management Committee, it's the DMC, sorry. And the HRA is Housing Revenue Account, sorry. That's because we attend too many meetings, I think. Sorry. They plan to borrow as much as they can go, as close as the £525.5 million to borrow. The one thing hasn't been mentioned in here tonight, which I was quite surprised, is the boys. Boys need to be attended because they are totally, there's 558 boys in the Camden, which I find very surprising.
And a boy is, exactly?
A boy is empty council house.
Thank you.
Sorry.
I know that.
I'm sorry. And I've actually been fighting with Somersdown with this CIP there for many, many years. And I've actually put a freedom of information, and we've never got the answer before. How much has it cost Camden Council so far to put the CIP in program, in the focus of Somersdown, like officers, wages, planning, the architects? I'm still waiting for the information, and I do believe I've been waiting 18 months, because I even asked Paul Thomason of Council to put it in for me, and he couldn't get the information, so they won't give the information that we request, so.
Right, so we're reaching a consensus that we want more transparency from the Council. Yes. That's one of our demands there. Let's make a demand at the end of this meeting. I've got to answer the question about the displaced residents, where do they go? The answer is into other council homes. So for Agar Grove, which is a very good example, the residents in the blocks that need to be emptied because they're going into demolition in about 2 years' time. I don't know why they emptied them so far in advance. They give the residents 300 housing points as a bonus, and that enables them to bid for other council homes. So basically, they're going into other council homes, and that's the point about the displacement. So while this is going on, there are, you know, 165 homes for a whole year out of action that other council tenants, other people in housing need, can't bid for. And if you look at the adverts, every week Camden publishes an advert for homes that you can bid for, and it tells you what happens to last year's bids, last week's bids. And sometimes as many as 500, 600, 700, 800 people will bid for a single flat. These are people who are on the housing list. We redid the allocation scheme. So the only people on the housing list are people who are assessed as needing housing. And they're given points and they bid competitively against each other. That's how it works. And 500 people, it's quite common to see that. I saw 800 and I was like, that's way too many. But we see 500 quite commonly. So there's a huge need for homes, and these homes that are waiting to be demolished, they're full of property guardians. They're not void, they're not empty, they're full of other people living there, but they're not serving Camden's residents in that time necessarily. Obviously, property guardians are residents too, I do represent some sometimes, but you know, the point I'm making is the people in most need in Camden are not getting homes during that time. So that's really good. I don't know the answer about high rents. That is, I'm racking up a little list of extra FOIs to put in, and one of them is world of new rents. We are seeing, in general, we are seeing high rents. There's a limit to how high you can go before it's not social rent anymore. Camden does have, if you look on their CIP website, there's a series of pledges, and one is, you know, we are talking about genuine council homes here, what's our preference. So they wouldn't go way above, but they would go up to the maximum they could, I think, in terms of new rents. Maybe right, maybe I'm just putting some people off. In terms of borrowing, the HRA is a housing revenue account. That's borrowing, you can borrow against the rent you'll get in the future. And sort of financial, sensible financial limits, you could borrow more than what we do in Camden. But there's an artificial cap that we can't go above, and you said it's 500 and something million. Yeah. So Camden does go up quite close to that. It leaves a little bit of leeway in case you need to borrow more for emergencies, like saving child bonds, although that's coming out of reserves. But that is an artificial limit. The government could lift that limit.
Exactly.
But I think we've got to propose the Camden options that work without that borrowing cap being lifted. Things like doing things with pension funds or working with community land trusts, because we can't say, oh, if government policy only changed, you'd be perfect, but carry on being rubbish in the meantime, because there's loads of things to improve.
Yeah.
That's all. And then Obi at the front here had a question. I think the guy at the back there had a question next, and then the person. So we'll do a little section there, basically, starting with Obi.
Yeah. Hi. I'm not a resident, well, I used to live in Camden, but then I couldn't afford it anymore. I'm a newborn at the moment. My cousin is living in Clapham Junction, and she was saying that they might get a new place because they might be her flats, her tower block might be demolished, but it's been stopped. I think something about Brexit, everything's becoming more expensive. In any case, the flat that they have been shown is actually smaller than her one bed, and it's her one bed is already really tiny. I'm just wondering, because in Camden, is there actually a minimum size for a one bed or two bed? And this one bed is actually, if it was in the open market, apparently it would cost something like £500,000. So it's actually crazy. But in any case, that's what I'm wondering about. Are they actually building new places, but it's going to be, I don't know, but empty safety deposit boxes for tax dodgers from other countries? Is it going to be properly, well, homes for people? Thank you.
My name is Constantine. The panel has mentioned densification in Infant. From the floor we heard pollution, and I would pitch pollution against densification in Infant. Pollution is not just the atmosphere, pollution is like psychological impact. Isolation, which happens with densification, alienation, cost of the NHS transport. Therefore, I would seriously have serious reservations, if not opposed, to densification. Now, there has been pointed out that other cities in Europe have denser populations, but in those cities you have cheap access to the countryside. In those cities on the continent, you have the countryside where you can roam across the countryside. It's not like the English countryside where you have to walk along hedged lanes. In other words, there's much more availability of open spaces in those cities. And London, the densification, we are being hemmed in like sardines, we are packed in, we have nowhere to go. And therefore, as much as I love what she said, I thoroughly oppose the infill and densification aspect.
My name's Steve. I live on the Regent's Park estate, and I've been densified now for the last 2 years. And it's worn me out a little bit.
Can you explain what's happening there?
Well, there's a bit of CIP scheme with Netley and a lot of HS2 scheme with HS2. And they call infill 11 storey tower block. That's infill where we are. Anyway, I don't want to dwell on that because it's too painful. Thank you very much for providing all this information. I've tried to compile it myself a while ago, and it's hard work to do and to get it right and to update it. So thank you very much for doing that for all of us, but for me especially. Since you've got all this stuff and you've looked into this in detail, what do you think is the reason that Camden are doing this the way they are doing it? Have you started to come to a conclusion about, is it to provide council housing? Is it to make money for the coffers? What is it for? You must have some inkling about that. And just to help you along, have you looked into compiling a database of how the waiting list is doing in Camden? Because one of the prime reasons from the 2010 report was to reduce the waiting list. I thought that was the prime objective. And just secondly, Slaney mentioned population growth. 47%, and it's not just Somers Towns, it's everywhere. They're expecting the population to increase by 50%-ish over the next 10 years. I mean, that is an absurd growth rate. And is it sustainable? And do you think that that's one of the drivers that they're doing? Do they think that we're all going to bud off?
We are now 5 minutes away from leaving the room. So if I can just very quickly say, in answer to the minimum sizes question, there are legal minimum sizes, but they're not very generous. The minimum size for a flat basically is 4-bed flats of 38 metres squared, which is pretty tiny if you think about how that is to split up into a kitchen, bathroom, and bedroom, all of that kind of thing. So you can do better. I think Dee mentioned the Parkham Morris, the Duckworth Lewis method of calculating houses is much more generous than that. I'll sum it up a little bit. I agree with Constantine that you've got this thing where you need to balance off densification versus whether you want your open spaces. Quite a lot of infill schemes that have been proposed by residents across London are add a couple of stories to something that's 2 stories high, or use a little corner which is unused. It's not sticking an enormous tower on every available space. So there's things, but also one of the things we've been talking about is better consultation, working with residents on their own neighbourhood, in the neighbourhood forums. The neighbourhood forum is a place to balance those things off. You don't have to choose one or the other. For each individual scheme, you can make the right choices by actually working with the residents. So I'm now going to hand over to Tom. And I think he's going to say, well, not to your strategy again, not to your question just now about what Sam's are doing it for.
I kind of agree with Constantine and Steve that there's basically been a failure of town planning regarding density. Yeah. That we're
conditions for building British cities are in any case dense enough to provide sufficient custom for services and transportation to make them efficient. So that's already built into the DNA of British city building. We have, instead of accommodating development at higher and higher, taller and taller buildings, we need to start asking our town planners to direct population growth into other places.
Yes.
It's absolutely basic.
Can I just try and sum up with some actions that you want to see, just rather, because obviously we talk about density for quite a long time, and I'm aware that
Couldn't we just ask them to adhere to their policies? They're supposed to have buildings 18 metres apart. I thought it was 28, it's 18. The Morrison's development, they said it was going to be 12. It's now 11 for the two types. And that's ridiculous. You can touch the people. You can set fire to the people. Or, you know, to be a little bit more serious about it. Density means claustrophobia.
In terms of the SIP, adhering to Camden's policies, I mean, Sony outlined a whole way, great range of ways that Somers Town didn't match up. I've never seen Camden turn down one of its own plans ever, and I think that is a real failure. You know, I mean, you think some of them would be bad, and yet none of them are. They're all perfect.
Do you want to sum up, Sony, some what you think we should be demanding?
Tom told us about this key word, placemaking, which is obviously a euphemism for asset making and place destroying. So perhaps a counter strategy should take up this term and say placemaking should mean community building, projects based on community consultation and community organization, broadly defined to include pension funds, links between trade unions and residence groups. That's what it should be, not asset making.
Thank you. That's very quick. Sally, would you like to sum up? We need some actions. We have got a sign-up sheet. We're running out of time. We've got a sign-up sheet at the back, and it'd be great if people could sign up to get updates. I think we should have further discussions. Maybe we can have a further discussion one day soon in one of the areas. Maybe we could do a walk and then a discussion or something like that. I've got a list of further information to try and get. Maintaining the website is one of my resolutions from today, keeping the things updated so that we still have this information, and making further demands on transparency. I'll be doing that. Would you like to say anything?
Well, I think transparency is key, and I think what we should be pushing for at this time, the new year, that we should be pushing for increased transparency in all capacities, particularly on the SIP. I would actually like to see projects put on hold until there is a kind of proper debate with the public about the way that we're going. So I think they are actually going in the wrong direction on some of their projects, not all. And I think that we've got to push environmental issues up the agenda, because people are screaming about air quality, they're screaming about open spaces, limits to growth, and we're just not being listened to.
I just wanted to go with this red button, so that's it.
If you've registered by Eventbrite, we can contact you one more time to say thank you through the Eventbrite system. We'll probably also invite you to join something like a MailChimp list so that we can keep you informed. We'll have another event. Maybe we'll go and visit Camden Street and see just how much space there is available and how Camden should be using it for affordable rents. Anyway, thank you all for coming. And yes, sign up if you want to see on MailChimp or just what you can do later.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you guys. Thank you so much. This is actually OB, occupying this network in Camden Town Hall. Okay. Bless up.